من التزم السلفية حصل الخير كله وحصل أجرا عظيما وفيرا كبيرا لأنه لزم هدي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وبارك على الأشرف الأنبياء ومرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، فحياكم الله جميعا وبارك الله فيكم. الحمد لله، we are still discussing the introduction from where we left off in our previous lesson, introduction of ath-Thalāthah al-Uṣūl. And we go on to discuss the affair of shirk, or what the affair of Allah Ta'ala commanding with tawheed and his warning against shirk. He's Allah Ta'ala commanding tawheed and a great prohibition against shirk. And so Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad Ibn Abdul Wahhab says, وَأَعْظَمْ مَا عَمَرَ اللَّهُ بِهِ التَّوْهِيدُ وهو إفراد الله بالعبادة وأعظم ما نهى عنه الشرك وهو دعوة غيره معه. And so Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad Ibn Abdul Wahhab, he mentions that the greatest thing that Allah commanded with is Tawheed, and this is singling out Allah Ta'ala alone in worship. And the greatest thing that he has warned against is a shirk. The greatest thing that is prohibited is a shirk, and this is calling upon him with other than him. And so Shaykh Aḥmad an-Najmī, in his explanation, he goes to say, فَالشِّرْكْ أَكْبَرْ مُحْبِتٌ لِلْعَمَلْ مُوجِبٌ لِخُلُورِ فِي النَّارِ قَالَ تَعَالَى أَلَى لِسَانَ عِيسَ بْنَ مَرْيَمْ يَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلُ اعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ رَبِّي وَرَبَّكُمْ إِنَّهُ مَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةَ وَمَأْوَاهُ النَّارُ وما للظالمين من أنصار. وقال تعالى إن الله لا يكفر أن يشرك به ويكفر ما دون ذلك لمن يشاء. وقال جل من قائل الذين آمنوا ولم يلبسوا إيمانهم بظلم أولئك لهم الأمن وهم مهتدون. And so the Shaykh mentioned, he goes on to discuss this affair of al-shirk akbar, the major shirk. And he mentions the major shirk is an action that causes a person's a'mal, their deeds, to be lost, and necessitates the person to be within the hellfire for eternity. So this is when you find, when it comes to shirk, sometimes the ulama, they will discuss shirk and define it by way of the uqubah. So they would define shirk and discuss shirk by way of its uqubah, by way of its consequence, or the punishment, and or the recompense which is attached to it. And here, Shaykh Aḥmad an-Najmī, rahimahullah, is doing the same. Where he mentions shirk, major shirk, is the affair that causes someone's action to be lost. So this is the first thing. This is where he's discussing, rahimahullah, he's discussing the consequence of shirk for a person in the dunya. So the action of the person that the person has performed, the deeds that they performed in the dunya, these are lost now due to the shirk akbar. Along with that, when discussing the shirk akbar, he goes on also to mention that it necessitates that someone resides in the hellfire for eternity. And so with this, the Shaykh is discussing the uqubah within the akhirah, so the punishment and the consequence in the akhirah for this affair of Shirk Akbar. And Allah Ta'ala mentions upon the tongue of Isa Ibn Maryam, O Bani Israel, worship Allah, my Lord and your Lord. Indeed, the one who associates anything in partnership with Allah, then Allah Ta'ala has made Jannah haram for him, and his abode is a hellfire. And there will be no one that comes to aid the wrongdoers. Likewise, Allah Ta'ala mentions, in Surah Nisa, indeed, Allah does not forgive the one that associates anything partial with him. However, he forgives anything that is lesser than that from which he wills. Likewise, Allah Ta'ala also mentions in Surah An'am, and those whom believe, those whom have faith, do not cloak or disguise their belief with oppression. Indeed, they are the individuals that have security and they are guided. And so, the Shaykh, he goes on to mention, وَقَدْ اِهْتَمَّ أَصْحَابُ رُسُولُ أَصْحَابُ رُسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ لِحَذِ الْآيَةِ. And so the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he gave importance and he held great importance with this ayah, this particular ayah. فَقَالُوا يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ أَيُّنَا لَا يَظْلِمُ نَفْسَهُ. And so he said, O Messenger of Allah, who from us is one that does not oppress oneself? فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إنه ليس الذي تذهبون إليه وإنما المراد بالظلم الشرك. ألم تسمع إلى قول لقمان لابنه يا بني لا تشرك بالله إن الشرك لظلم عظيم. And so the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he mentioned that is not the affair that you are thinking of. In relation to when he was asked, who is the one that will oppress themselves? He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, says, it's not what you are thinking of. Rather, the intent of the shirk, or the intent of dhulm, rather, is a shirk. Have you not heard the statement of Luqman to his son, oh my son, do not associate anything in partnership with Allah. Indeed, shirk is a great form of oppression. وفي الرواية ليس هو كما تظنون إنما هو كما قال لقمان لابنه. There's another riwaya, another narration, where it mentions that it's not as you think, rather it is as Luqman stated to his son. And again, he mentions the ayah. Within this ayah here, Surah Al-An'am, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا إِيمَانَهُمْ بِالظُّلْمِ أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنُ وَهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ. By way of this, we understand that the one that has true iman, they cannot be those that have shirk within their actions and mix shirk into their actions. Likewise, Allah Ta'ala, He's mentioned the reward for those that have true iman and those that don't mix this affair of dhulm, shirk within their actions. And he mentions Tabarak wa Ta'ala that they have security and they have guidance, they are guided. And so here, as Shaykh Zayd and Madkhali, rahimahullah, he mentions in relation to this ayah, that the individual that does not fall into shirk and adheres to the affair of Tawheed and the iman, then the recompense is security, and the recompense likewise is guidance itself. And no doubt we all need the guidance of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. And the Shaykh goes on to mention, وَمَا أَنَا يَعْبُدُونَ يُوَحِّدُونَ لِأَنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَقْبَلُ الْإِبَادَ إِلَّا بِالتَّوْحِيدِ كَمَا أَنَّ الصَّلَاةَ لَا تَكُونَ صَلَاةً إِلَّا بِالتَّهَارَةِ فَكَذَلِكَ الْإِبَادَ لَا تَكُونَ إِبَادَةً إِلَّا بِالتَّوْحِيدِ وَقَدْ جَاءَ فِي الْحَدِيثِ عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فيما يرويه عن ربه أنه قال أنا أغنى شركاء عن الشرك فمن عمل عملا أشرك معي من عمل عملا أشرك معي فيه غيري تركته وشركه. And so the meaning of يعبدون, the meaning of يعبدون is يوحدون. يعبدون, to worship, I also single out Allah Ta'ala alone in that worship. And this is due to the fact that Allah Ta'ala does not accept an action of ibadah unless it's with tawheed. Unless it's with tawheed. So we understand that this affair of tawheed, or this affair of ibadah, rather, cannot be considered to be true, cannot truly be considered to be ibadah unless it's with tawheed. Just as the salah cannot be considered to be the salah in reality, unless the person has tahara, unless the person is in the state of purity. And so this is the example given here by Shaykh Aḥmad an-Najmī, mirroring the example that Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad Abdul Wahhab mentions in his Muqaddimah of Qawaid Arba'a, his introduction to the four principles of shirk, where the example and comparison is given in relation to the salah. Individually, they can relate to the salah. As a Muslim, we pray five times a day. We can relate to this affair. And we can relate to the affair of performing the wudu and performing tahara generally, being in the state of purity. Whether that's in the state of purity within our own selves, or the state of purity within our clothing, or the state of purity in relation to the place that we are praying. All of these have to be in this particular state in order for the salah to be considered the salah in reality. And so when someone has understanding of this and comprehension of this particular point, it allows them then understand the comparison being given with tawheed. Because we have the literal example of the salah. And so it aids understanding the comparison between tawheed and ibadah. That ibadah generally is in need of tawheed, just as the salah is in need of tahara. And ibadah cannot be considered to be ibadah, cannot be completed except with tawheed, just as the salah cannot be considered to be the salah and cannot be completed except with tahara. And Shaykh Ahmad, he's going to mention, and then we have the hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam narrates from his Lord. This is, as we know, is referred to as the hadith Qudsi. Hadith Qudsi. And there are, just as a side point in relation to a hadith, there are different terminologies in relation to narration, should we say, depending upon who is the rawi, or who is the one narrating, or who does the matan, who is the actual text of that narration come from. And so the highest of them is the hadith Qudsi. The highest of them is the hadith Qudsi. The hadith Qudsi is the narration where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he narrates directly from his Lord Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. After that you have a hadith which is marfu', And the narration which is marfu' is the one which is ascribed to the Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. Thereafter, You have the narration which is mawquf. Narration which is mawquf. And this is the narration which is not ascribed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but rather is ascribed to one of his companions. And thereafter, you have the narration which is maqtur. Narration which is maqtur. And this is a narration which is ascribed to the tabi'i or anyone thereafter. And so these are terminologies in relation to the matan, the text of the hadith. And who's narrating that narration? And now, this narration here is as the Shaykh says, as the Shaykh mentions, is a hadith Qudsi. The hadith al-Qudsi. And within the narration, it mentions that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam narrated from his Lord that I am the most self-sufficient of those that associate in partnership with me. And so whoever does an action associating anything in partnership with me, then I have left him and his shirk. I have left him and his shirk. فالشرك نجاسة للقلوب وينجسها ويحبط العمل جميعا سواء جاءت من القلب أو من اللسان أو من الجوارح. ولهذا قال الله عز وجل وثيابك فطهر والرجز فاحجر. And shirk is an affair of najasa, is an affair of filth and impurity upon the heart. It's an affair of filth and impurity that falls upon the hearts. And thus, likewise, causes the hearts to become impure and causes all actions to be lost, whether they be actions that had emanated from the heart or the tongue, or actions that had emanated from the limbs. And due to that, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala mentions Surah Al-Mudathir, and purify your garments and stay away from the idols. And the Shaykh, he concludes this point, Shaykh Ahmad, rahimahullah, he concludes this point by mentioning, وَمِنْ هُنَا نَعْلَمْ أَنَّ الْمُشْرِكِ مَهْمَا تَقَرَّبْ إِلَى اللَّهِ مِنْ عِبَادَةٍ فَهِيَا بَاطِلٌ وَحَابِطٌ لا يقبل الله منها شيئا وما دامت ممزوجة بالشرك. And so, due to all of this now, we come to know that the mushrik, the one that falls into shirk, regardless of what the action is, his ibadah is batil, is null and void, and is lost. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not accept anything from him whilst he's in the state of mixing his ibadah with the worship and the directing his worship to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Shaykh al-Islam, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, he goes on to mention al-amr bil tawheed wa nahy al-shirk wa dalil qawluhu ta'ala wa'budu Allah wa la tushriku bi shay'a. So the Shaykh, he mentions the dalil. The Shaykh goes on to mention it, the proof for these points mentioned previously, which is the command of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in Surah An-Nisa, and worship Allah, yani worship Allah ta'ala alone, and do not associate anything in partnership with Him. And the Shaykh, he mentions in his ta'liq, in his commentary upon this ayah, وَقَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى وَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا فَهَذِهِ الْآيَةِ اشْتَمَلَتْ عَلَىٰ أَعْظَمَ الْعَمَرِ وعلى أعظم النهي فأعظم العمل هو التوحيد وأعظم النهي هو الشرك شكر أكبر مخرج من الملة. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentions worship Allah ta'ala alone and do not associate anything in partnership with Him. This ayah is comprehensive of the greatest command and the greatest prohibition. And so the greatest thing that is commanded with is Tawheed. And the greatest thing that is prohibited is major shirk that causes an individual to leave the fold of Islam. And alhamdulillah, that is the conclusion of the introductions to Thalāthah al-Uṣūl. And bi-ibnillahi ta'ala, in our next sitting, we can go on to discuss the usul, the asl awal, and other than those, inshaAllah ta'ala. Fabarakhu lahu feekum, wa jazakum ala khayra, wa sallallahu wa barak ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.
Khairan jazakallahu khair, ya Ustādh. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept this from you in the scales of good deeds in the hereafter.
Ameen, ameen. Barakallahu feekum, ikhwan.
Wa feek barakallah. Jazakallahu khair.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, ya Ustādh.